So let's get started with what we're going to be covering tonight. As soon as this loads. So we're going to be talking about today about the stock market, but it's no use me telling you, and I'm not here to sell you anything, I promise, but it's more to teach you how the stock market works, why you should be investing, and also why you then at the end, which is the sales pitch, why you should be investing with APSA stockbrokers. Okay. But majority of tonight is going to be focused on the stock market, what it's about, and how it works, and why you should be there. All right. So first things first. There is unfortunately a bit of a misunderstanding always with us, in South Africa especially, in what is the difference between saving and investing. I know most of us think we know it, and most of us are right, we do know it, but just to make sure that we're all clear, let's just get this out of the way. Okay. Savings is short term. Now, I know, and today I don't have my APSA hat on as from a banking point of view because the banks hate me for saying this, but your 32-day deposits, your money market accounts, and these type of things aren't an investment tool for one simple reason. Your interest rate on it, I mean, for most people, is roughly about 6%. If inflation is at 6%, what exactly are you getting back? You're getting nothing. Your money's not growing. So if you put your money in there for the next 5 years, in 5 years' time, your money is actually worth the exact same it was 5 years ago. All right? It doesn't grow at all. Then you've got to take into account something called costs, which is something we all forget. And not just cost in its rand value, but cost as a percentage of your investment. Now, I want you to remember this point for the rest of the night and for further as well. But when you take your cost as a percentage of your investment, and what we mean by that is, if you've invested 100 rand a month in something and it costs you 10 rand, it actually means that your cost as a percentage is 10%. And that means that whatever you've invested in has to grow by 10% just to cover that cost. So now if you've got inflation at 6%, your cost as a percentage at 10%, it means you've got to grow by 16% just to break even. You've got to grow more than that in order for your money to grow. So that's the reason why when it comes to investing, savings products like 32-day deposits and the likes are not investment products. They are saving products. They have a purpose, and believe you me, you can use them, but it's for the short term. Save up for a holiday, something like that, okay? And also remember, with it, you're also taking very low risk on it. With investments, and this is where the big difference comes in, you're taking on higher risk. Your money 9 out of 10 times is not guaranteed. But because of you taking on that higher risk, you obviously expect a higher return. And you have to be beating inflation and the likes. But the most important thing is investments is a long-term thing. It's not here for a year, it's not for 2 years. You're looking at 5 years plus. Okay. And that's pretty much how simple it is. That's the big difference between the two. So with that out of the way, what is the stock market? So the stock market is ultimately an investment tool. Some do use it for trading purposes, and to understand that very, very quickly, and for the rest of today's presentation, I'll use quite a bit of examples to help you understand things as well. Okay? But just by a quick show of hands, who knows the best trader in the world? Okay, I can't hear what somebody said, so you're going to have to say it louder. Okay, so we've got Buffett. Anybody else? There we go. So we've got quite a few people calling out all the names of people who are billionaires, but none of them are traders. Warren Buffett has never bought and sold anything in his life. He's got a strategy of buy and hold. He's an investor. A trader is the person who buys and sells continuously. And what has been proven over time is that currently in the world today, we do not have any US billionaire traders. We do have quite a few US billionaire investors. Okay? So if you want to use the stock market for trading, go for it. But just to understand, there's a very good chance you're not going to make as much money as the person who's doing both, trading and investing. Trading can help you just basically make a little bit, but understand you're going to lose a lot as well. Investing for the long term, there's a very good chance you're going to make a lot of money. And investing in the stock market is not at all complicated. It's actually one of the easiest things to do. The scary part is we actually invest in companies every single day. What do I mean by that? It's quite simple. Where do you do your grocery shopping? It's probably Woolworths, Spar, Checkers, right? Okay. Where do you bank? APSA, Standard, Nedbank, Capitec, whatever the case may be. How many of you pay bank fees? There we go. So how many of you are actually contributing to a company, to its success? Right? When you buy your groceries and the likes, companies like ShopRite and the likes make money. You've actually gone and actually basically given them their profit and for them to make their money. You're also continuously investing in the stock market if you have an RA, a pension fund. I mean, we all, especially lately in the news over the last few months and even the last year, everybody's heard about the PIC, the Public Investment Corporation. What do? They manage government's pension. How do they do it? They are massive shareholders in all different companies listed on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange. So they take all the pension money and they invest it in various companies. I mean, they own things like 6% of Standard Bank. They own, I think, I don't know what the percentage now, but it's closer to about 12% of Barclays Africa Group and so forth. Your pension is sitting in there. And the scary part of all of this in South Africa is the majority of the population have no idea where their money is actually sitting. Just by a quick show of hands, and in no way is this an insult or anything else, but how many of you actually know exactly where your investment is sitting if you have a unit trust, an RA, or a pension? And when I say know exactly where it's sitting, it's not sitting with APSA Unit Trust or with Alan Gray or with whoever else. How many of you actually know that your pension was not invested heavily in African Bank or Lehman Brothers because it has to follow Reg 28, so it's got a bit of an offshore component? How many of us actually know that? How many of us know that in 2008, a lot of people that were retiring that year were actually not able to retire that year very well? 2008 is when the stock market collapsed. South Africa was more than 25%. The rest of the world was even more. Because when they, at the end of 2008, when they were looking at retiring, from the beginning to the end, they pretty much lost more than 25% of the value of their pension. So our money is already sitting in the stock market. It's all sitting there. The difference is that we need to start now understanding how is that impacting us. Okay? And the stock market, like I say, it's not a complicated thing. It's actually very, very easy. You'd be quite insulted as South Africans, I hope, to know that more than 40% of Australia's population invest themselves in the stock market. Now, I'm quite certain that we are cleverer than the Australians. We're definitely better at sport than them. Okay? That must be an Australian laughing. But we do quite well there. So, I mean, I know we are. And considering the fact that half of Australia is with South Africans, well, that's also another story. So if they're doing it, why aren't we? Why is it that we are so far behind? The simple reason is we do not take the time and effort to actually look after our money. We rather spend it, we're known for this, we spend a lot of our money on cars, depreciating assets. It's not an asset, it's actually a liability as far as I'm concerned. But that's what we do. We spend a lot more on it. We're one of the few countries in the world where it's actually legal for you to buy a car over 72 months, so not 5 years, that's 6 years, and then on top of that have a balloon or residual payment of 30-40%, which basically means you're going to be in debt for the rest of your life with a car. Right? That's what it actually means. The rest of the world have moved way beyond that and said, well, in certain countries, it's actually illegal to do that. Yeah, we do it purely because of the fact that the demand is there. There's so much of a demand for it. But we'll get to how much time we spend on cars later. Okay? So let's do a quick crash course on the stock market. The stock market, firstly, it works like any market out there. There's somebody selling something and somebody wanting to buy it. It's exactly the same as if you were to go and buy a pair of jeans. The stock market needs to work exactly the same. So how does it work when you want to buy a pair of jeans? So there's a bit of research that goes into it, right? Okay? You need to know what size you are. All right? You can't assume, especially if you're buying it for your wife, girlfriend, or whatever the case may be, you can't make an assumption that they're a 34 or a 38 centimeter waist, because then you're going to be in trouble. Okay? So there's a bit of research that goes into it. Then you look at your budget. What can you afford? So let's say you have 500 Rand that you can afford on a pair of jeans. You've done your research and you decided, you know what, the one that you really like that fits you nicely and everything else is a guest jeans. So you want to buy the guest jeans. You go to Edgar's. Edgar's has the jeans for 520 Rand. Can you buy that pair of jeans? You've got 500 Rand. No, you can't. It is not the Oriental Plaza, so you can't negotiate. Okay? The price is set. So what do you do next? You take a walk to the next store in the mall. You go to Truworths or you go somewhere else, or maybe to the guest shop itself. So if Truworths have the pair of jeans for 490 Rand, do you still pay them 500 Rand? No. You give them the 500 Rand, they'll give you a pair of jeans and 10 Rand change, correct? That's exactly how the stock market works. You need to find out which company you want to invest in, all right? Make sure that you have enough available to invest in it. Once you've invested in it, you go online or you call your broker and you tell them that you wish to buy this share at this price. They put your order in the market, and if a seller comes along that says, you know what, that's a nice price, I wish to sell it at, they'll sell you the shares. You get the shares, the seller gets the cash. It's all done on a regulated exchange and it's all done anonymously. So you don't know who's the buyer and who's the seller. Okay. That's how simple it is. The complication part comes in what you're seeing now. We now need to start looking at the performance of companies. And this is where the research comes in. Okay? Again, don't go and buy a share just because somebody told you that's the one you must buy, or because you guess that's the right one. Because again, you're going to be in trouble, like buying the wrong pair of jeans for your wife. All right. But this is the complicated part. And believe it or not, it's actually quite simple. So just a few things to go through. We talk about a bid and an offer in the stock market. The bid is the price at which somebody wants to buy the shares at. The offer is the price that somebody wants to sell the shares at. A trade happens when those two agree on a price, and somebody sells it and somebody buys it. That's what it, when a trade happens. Okay. That's as simple as can be. Exactly like I said, as if going shopping for a pair of jeans. Right? Then there's other things in there. Now we start going into what we call the jargon. Dividend yield, PE ratios, all of these type of things. The scary part is that every single person in this room, I can bet, actually understands what's fiber, right? I can guarantee you also know what ADSL does, right? And how many of you actually know what ADSL stands for? No, don't put up your hand, please. Because if you're going to tell me, that's about the fourth person that's told me what it stands for, and I promise you I'll still never remember what it stands for. But the fact of the matter is we all know what it does, correct? Okay? Why? Why do we know what it does? Because we need it, correct? We need to get access to the internet, so we found out, oh, wait a minute, I have ADSL. What's this thing called fiber that everybody's talking about? I don't need to understand the whole in-depth system of how it works, but I do need to know that fiber does do something. It gives me, can give me better, more reliable internet, okay? When you're entering into the investment space, you need to also start learning that jargon. And there's actually a tool out there which can explain every single word to you. So if I were to tell you what's a PE ratio, which is that, by the way, over there, and you don't understand what it is, there's this fantastic tool. It's called Google. That's it. Google it. And then when you're done Googling it, you can go and buy shares in Google as well. But the fact of the matter is this, is that you're going to have to learn the jargon. And if you don't learn the jargon, you're not going to understand a lot of things as well. Something like a P/E ratio and a dividend yield is actually the two most important things that you should understand when it comes to investing in the stock market. And what we mean by that is quite simply this. A P/E ratio actually tells you whether or not a company A or company B is cheaper or more expensive. Now, what do we mean by that? If you see the share price right now, and I've got a share price up here of Woolworths, okay? So Woolworths, and by the way, the share price is always in cents, okay? So what you're seeing there, 6,975, is 69 rand and 75 cents, okay? Now, is Woolworths at 69 rand and 75 cents more expensive than ShopRite Checkers, or cheaper, I should say, than ShopRite Checkers, which is at above 170 rand? Well, basically what we've been taught all our lives is that 170 is more than 69, right? But that's not actually the case, because it's the way shares are issued and the way the price is calculated. So what I mean by that is, if you take company A, and let's say company A is worth 10 rand, company B is also worth 10 rand. So if you wanted to buy these two companies, you'd pay 10 rand for them, okay? But company A decides to issue 10 shares. That'll make its share price 1 rand. Okay? Company B decides to only issue 5 shares. It would make its share price 2 rand. It does not mean that company B is worth double what company A is. They're exactly the same. So P/E ratios is what is used to actually determine whether one is cheaper or more expensive. The higher the P/E ratio, okay, then another company's P/E ratio in the same sector, and I'll explain that just now, what sectors are. But they're the same companies basically in the same industry. If one is higher, it means the one is more expensive. It's better value to buy the one that is lower. All right. And right now, you're going to get homework, by the way. So there's going to be quite a bit of homework, by the way, if you want to know. You're going to need to go and understand how P/E ratio is calculated. Price earnings ratio. So that's the whole start of the homework. Go home and find out exactly how this works. Because you need to understand that to when you're going to be comparing companies. And we're going to talk about that just now. Okay? The other one is actually a very easy one. It's called dividend yield. Does everybody know what dividends are? I love the way we nod and say yes. Okay. If you know what dividends are, that means you know that as of whenever the announcement was, you are no longer paying 15% dividend tax. You are now paying 20% dividend tax. Okay. Does that come out of your pocket? Well, no, not exactly. It's actually, you get the net of it. Okay. So there's a bit more complication to dividends. But ultimately, this is dividends. When a company that is doing very well, that has a very good long history, and they make a good profit, they reward you as a shareholder for investing in their company. Because when you buy a share, what you're actually doing is, you are giving capital to a company to grow itself, to actually grow, to spend, to do whatever it needs to do. Instead of a company going to a bank and borrowing money, they go to the stock exchange and list and raise capital that way from ordinary people and companies and the likes out there, okay? So naturally, when that company does well, you as a shareholder get rewarded because you own, when you buy one share, you actually own a piece of a company. So you get to partake in those profits. And they then declare the profits. They normally declare it in rands and cents, obviously. And the dividend yield is a percentage. That's all it is. It's taking that rand and cents that they declare as dividends, divided by the share price at that time, and that gives you your dividend yield. So why is dividend yield so important? Well, because that is actually the percentage that you earn as an income. So in other words, what do we mean by that? If the dividend yield, if share price is at 10 rand and somebody pays a 2 rand dividend, sorry, so that's what, 20% almost. That's a bit high. Make it 100 rand and 2 rand, okay? So that's 2%. That literally means you've earned 2% worth of interest almost on your investment. And dividends are normally paid biannually by companies, right? And you can calculate it, obviously, from, you can see it on the website, you can get it anywhere. By the way, and the reason why I use this over here is this is actually from Google. So you don't even need to have an account with us to get this information. You can literally go into Google, type in the words Woolworths Holdings, and it will give you that information right there, this part over here. That you need a stockbroker for.
Okay.
But that's dividends and that's PE ratios. There is a lot more to understand as well, but we'll get to that as well later on.
Okay.
But now we've got a basic understanding of the stock market. The next thing that you need to understand is something which is with any investment. Risk versus return. If you're going to take exceptionally high risk, you're obviously going to be expecting a higher return. But the thing that we forget is understanding risk. And what I mean by that is there's no way you can control certain risks. There are certain risks that you're going to take no matter what. What do I mean by that? So let's say you invest in a property, not a primary property, the one you live in, a secondary one. You're going to rent that out. By renting it out, you're actually getting dividends, right? That's your rental income. But now, before you rent that property out, you obviously have to research it because they say there's three rules in property, right? Who knows the three rules? There we go. Location, location, location. Okay? And the reason why that's the three rules is because you're taking on risk with your capital. If you buy a property and that area becomes a very bad area, obviously the value of your property goes downhill.
Okay?
And you lose money. So that's why they say that's the most important thing. Then comes the rental part of it. Now there's risk associated with renting. The risk being you get a tenant in there who can't afford it. Now suddenly you don't get an income anymore, right? Can you do anything about that? No, there's a certain amount that you can do. So before you actually decide to give the tenant the property to rent, you're going to ask for things like bank statements, you're going to ask for proof of income and those type of things. And you're going to see if they can afford it, right? Okay, now the tenant's in there. Do you have a guarantee the tenant is not going to throw a nice wild party and burn the entire house down, literally? No. So what do you do to try and eliminate that risk as much as you can? You can't stop that from happening, but you'll take out insurance, right? Okay. Have you eliminated any risk? No, you haven't, but you've reduced it. You've reduced a certain amount of risk. And that applies with any investment. You've got to understand the risks. You may not be able to do anything about it, but try and understand it and try and see what you can do about it. So in the stock market, we talk about financial risk, talk about liquidity risk, we talk about exchange rate risk, we even talk about political risk as well. Financial risk. Investing in companies that are not financially sound. Now, in the stock market, you get literally four types of companies, if I can put it that way. Okay? You get, firstly, what we call our large cap companies, very well-established companies, your top 40 companies, your top 500 companies in the world. These are your large, well-established companies, okay? If I say the name APSA, if I say the name Standard Bank, Woolworths, if I say Pick n Pay, everybody knows who they are. You even know who's Anglo-American, you know who's BHP Billiton. These are companies that have been around for many years. They do very well over time especially. And these are actually the companies that normally pay very good dividends because they're not using their profits to build further. They actually can take the profits, use a little bit of it for something, and the rest can reward shareholders. Okay? Then you've got what we call our mid-cap companies. And by the term mid, meaning medium. It's a medium-sized company. These are companies you'll find that don't often pay dividends. Why don't they pay dividends? Because these are companies that are trying to grow. So, believe it or not, companies like Spar, the City Lodge Group, and the likes, they are still classified as medium cap companies. When they get their profits, they're trying to obviously still grow the business, so they use it for that. So you may not get a good income from them, but you will get maybe a better share price growth than with a large cap company. But yet again, you're taking on a bit more risk there. Okay. Then we get what we call small cap companies, the penny stocks. These are exceptionally high risk companies. These are companies which haven't been around very long. They're normally startups. And they can either make it big or, like the saying says, go home. So in other words, you can put 10,000 Rand in today and tomorrow you can have zero because they've gone bust. So those are the very high-risk ones. Okay? The fourth one on the list, and we'll talk about that just now, is called exchange-traded funds.
Okay.
The best thing since sliced bread, as everybody calls it in our space. And we'll talk about it and why you should be starting with them.
Okay.
But from those three, the other thing that they also have up there is what we call liquidity risk. Now, liquidity in our space talks specifically about the ability to buy and sell shares at a fair price easily. And that easily word is very, very important, because what it means is this. If you hold 100,000 shares in whatever company, in APSA, and you want to sell those shares immediately tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock, is there somebody that's going to buy the entire 100,000 from you, and will you get a fair price? So the fair price, we mean the share closed at about 100 Rand for argument's sake, and the worst case you'll get out at is about 99 Rand. That's roughly about a fair price.
Okay.
So large cap companies have this liquidity. You'll see them trading every second of the day. As you go down to the mid cap and the penny shares, the liquidity starts drying up because there's not a huge demand for those type of shares. In fact, penny shares have got a very, very big swing. You could literally buy the share today for 10 cents, and if you try and sell it tomorrow, the person on the bid side may only be at 1 cent. There's no liquidity there. In fact, if you look at penny shares on the stock market, you'll see that a lot of them don't even have a single trade for a week, maybe even. Right. So that's the thing when we say liquidity risk. So you've got to look at what we call the volume, and if I go back there, when we say volume, that's what we're talking about over there. What type of volume does it have?
Okay.
Then we talk about exchange rate risk. Why would we talk about exchange rate risk? We're talking about companies listed on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange. So what does exchange rate have to do with any of them? And no, it does not have to do with anything with the banking debacle that's currently happening.
Okay.
What does exchange rate risk have to do with your investment? Who can tell me which company here in South Africa only has an exposure in South Africa from your top 40 companies? Let's use an example. Does everybody know MTN, right? Okay. Where's MTN's risk? Nigeria? Iran? South Africa?
Its own management.
Its own management. The scary part of MTN is they used to make most of their money from Nigeria. And I say used to because of what has happened over the few years. Okay? But they have an exchange rate risk. If the exchange rate between us and Nigeria were to change in any way, it impacts the profits that they're going to make. The same applies with virtually every single company around. I mean, Woolworths is sitting in Australia, sitting in London. The exchange rate between those countries will impact its profits. Right? British American Tobacco, Steinhoff, all of these companies make a hell of a lot of money from overseas. British American Tobacco, in fact, they declare their dividends in pounds and then convert it to rands. It can impact even now your dividend yield as well. So the exchange rate risk is very, very important. Can you do anything about it? No. There's absolutely nothing. Nobody here has enough money in this room combined to impact the exchange rate, either positively or negatively.
Okay.
So you can't do anything about it, but that doesn't mean that you just ignore it. You've got to keep track of it, that means.
Okay.
Then the last one, political risk. You have to start knowing where your investments are sitting in which countries. MTN is a very nice example. Nigeria and Iran. Not very too stable countries politically. We saw that with the fines they're getting. We saw that with the problem when sanctions were placed on Iran and the likes. They couldn't get their money out. That's going to impact you. Again, you cannot go and solve the world problems, but you need to understand it so that when that does happen, you may want to be thinking about moving your investment out of MTN and maybe into Vodacom.
Okay.
That's the type of things you've got to understand. So we can't do much about a lot of these, but if we understand it, it will help us to make very good informed decisions.
Okay.
And I hope by now you're starting to understand why you better start finding out where your pensions and the likes are sitting. Okay, because if your pension was sitting in MTN, well, MTN year on year hasn't been doing that well.
Okay.
So anyway, the next thing is, once you've understood that, there's one more thing that you need to understand about yourself. You are a risk to your own investments. And what type of risk also can you afford to take? So I'm jumping into diversification and that there because I know everybody wants to hear the top slide, but what type of risk can you take? Let's look at the two scenarios, okay? So everybody's going to say, no, they don't mind taking on risk if I tell them about NASPERS. Sorry. 1996, if you spent 100,000 Rand, which is equivalent to 337,000 Rand today, if you invested that into NASPERS, you would be worth 26 million Rand today. That's over 20 years. Okay, everybody happy with that? At that point in time, NASPERS was not a top 40 share. When NASPERS listed, it was not part of the top 40 shares in South Africa. So it was classified as a medium cap company. It meant you were taking on higher risk. But if I told you that story, every single person in the room here would say, yeah, I'm happy to take on high risk, right? Okay. Let's talk about those that like to take on low risk. Die data. So early 2000, everybody knows what happened in 2000. For those of you that are the millennial generation, whatever you're called, you guys may not know this, but our computers couldn't count from 1999 to 2000. Okay? So huge amounts of money was spent on infrastructure and servers and all of these things. And one of the companies that was producing all of these things was actually Die Data. By 2000, Die Data was listed in the top 40 shares because its share price and the capital that it was worth, sorry, the amount it was worth, was actually worth in the top 40 of shares. Its share price sat at 75 Rand. That was the high it reached in 2000. It was just over 75 Rand. By 2010 or so, when it delisted eventually, the share price was 13 Rand. So are you high risk or low risk? Okay. So the reason why I put that up there is not to help you change your mind on risk or anything else, but I need you to start understanding risk. And risk isn't about the fact that just where does a company lie in that graph over there. Risk is about the company you're investing in as well. What type of risk do you want to take? You've got to be honest with yourself. Because we're going to talk about shortly right now about strategy, which is if you've fallen off to sleep, wake up when we get to strategy, because that's the important part of tonight. Okay? But the point that I'm making is risk, you've got to be honest and you've got to understand what risk you can take. And the risk doesn't just apply to the fact of saying, well, you know what, the companies in the top 40 are actually the low-risk companies, so I should invest my money in there. They could very well be a Die Data sitting in there. Look at the risk that you're willing to take, understand it, and then make a decision on where you're going. And the most important thing is diversification. Okay? You're not going to get anywhere without diversification. If you invested in both these companies at that exact point of their highs and lows, you'd all be fine, right? Okay, you'd still be in profit of at least 10 million Rand. But if you only invested in one, well, depending on which one you chose, you could be in a very different situation. And that's the point of diversification. Never ever invest in the same sector. And when we say sectors, we refer to things such as your industrial sector, the IT sector, the finance sector. Those are sectors, and in those sectors, you find companies in those sectors. Finance sector, that's where all the banks are. Okay? Food sector, that's where you're finding Pick and Pay, ShopRite, and the likes. Right? We do also have a sin sector in the stock exchange. It's an unofficial sector. Who knows what's the sin sector? They're also called defensive shares. South African Breweries, which is now ABDev or whatever it's called, British American Tobacco, those are called the sin shares, okay? Because those are the shares that regardless if times are good or bad, does well. Why? When times are bad, are we drinking less? No, we're drinking still the same. When times are good, we drink even more, okay? If you look at SAB and them share price, regardless of what the market is doing, it's pretty much just anchoring along nicely. Okay. Takes a knock here and there because of exchange rates and that there, but ultimately it's doing fine. Right. So there you go. If you want to invest in something and you're not sure what to invest in, choose the Sun shares. Over 10 years, they'll give you something back.
Okay.
Just by the way, those two companies also had, well, I should say had the highest paying CEOs. Both of them, the CEOs earned over 100 million rand per annum. Not a bad salary, right? Okay. And us smokers and drinkers, well, we contributed to that, so. And you contributed to great dividends and the like, so thank you very much.
Okay.
But there you go. So diversification, spread it across everything. You've got to spread it across everything so your risk is basically reduced. If you're going to invest just in gold, what happens when the economy is doing very well? Gold shares are going to do that. There goes your profits again.
Okay.
But if you're in gold, and now you can't go and say, well, I've diversified, I've bought actual gold. And by the way, you can buy physical gold in South Africa, and I'll talk about it just now. But you can't say, I've got gold, and then I've also bought Anglo Gold Ashanti shares. Then I've bought BHP Billiton shares, and therefore I'm diversified. No, you're not diversified. You're all focused in the mining sector. All right. When we say diversification, out of you've got to invest in each sector. Finance, mining, and the likes. All right. But the problem with that is, and I'm going to just jump ahead here quickly. The problem with that is that you can't actually just do that when you're starting out with 250 Rand or 500 Rand a month that you want to invest in, or even 1,000 Rand. Because you can't exactly go and buy a Naspers shares, a Standard Bank share, I don't know, an MTN share, an Anglo share on 1,000 Rand. Naspers is over 2,000 Rand a share. So it becomes exceptionally hard to diversify if you're going to buy one share literally in each sector. It's going to start costing quite a bit. Not to mention the fact that every single time you buy a single share in the different companies, you're going to get charged brokerage. So your cost is going to go up. So what's the easiest way to get diversification? Exchange traded funds, ETFs.
Okay.
So there's a whole long explanation over there that I put up for everybody, and I'm hoping that nobody at the back can read it, because that's your homework. You need to go to www.absastockbrokers.co.za. There's a nice little tab there that says education. Click on the education tab, and it actually opens up a very nice document for you to read. Go to section 3.1 in there, and read up on ETFs.
Okay.
I'm going to give you a simplified version of it so you can get a basic understanding of it so you know why you should be starting with it. But I need you to go and spend some time there with it. All right. An exchange traded fund, all it does is it basically gives you diversification at a fraction of the cost with the same returns as if you invested in the share yourself. What do I mean by that? Simply this. I'm going to use an exchange traded fund called Absa New Gold, right? Because everybody understands how gold works. And I'm going to take some risk into it as well. So Absa New Gold is an exchange-traded fund. What it does is it allows you to actually get exposure to physical gold. Now, what do I mean by exposure? What it means is you don't actually own the gold. It means the market maker owns the gold. You can take ownership and the likes of it, but ultimately the market maker owns the gold. So what benefit is that to you? It's simple. Every time you buy literally 100 shares in Absa New Gold, Absa, as the market maker, has to physically go and buy 1 ounce of gold. So what does that mean? It means then that you technically are exposed to that 1 ounce of gold and the price of that 1 ounce of gold. So if the gold price is, for argument's sake, $1,000, because it's quoted in dollars, and the exchange rate is 10, that means you're pretty much exposed to 20,000 rands worth of gold. Sorry, yeah, 10,000 rand. Okay? But that's actually what it means. The thing is, the market maker is so heavily regulated that they get audited and they have to hedge accordingly on that. Why do they have to do that? Because the saying goes as follows. If tomorrow APSA stockbrokers is not around, Standard Bank is not around, or any other broker, there's only two brokers left in this country for whatever reason, you hold shares or an ETF in a country and we are gone, do you still own those shares? Yes. In fact, the JSE regulates it so much that basically if APSA stockbroker is not here tomorrow and you bought your shares through us, they literally pick up the phone the next day after we're gone and go, sorry, where can I move your shares to? Which broker? The same applies with an ETF. The JSE regulates it so well that they have to go and buy that physical gold. And they have to do that purely because of the fact that tomorrow, if you own an exchange-traded fund and the market maker is no longer around, all that happens is that entire gold gets transferred over to the new market maker. You still own an ETF. That's how it is. You don't have to worry about its storage. You don't have to worry about keeping it safe under your mattress or in a safe or in a... Well, storage boxes apparently aren't that safe either anymore. So you can do all of these. You literally don't need to worry about it. If the market maker, like in APSA's case, who keep the gold in somewhere in the UK, I don't know where, don't ask me. They've got, by the way, they're the third, if I'm not mistaken, they're the third largest ETF in the world, which pretty much means they've got enough gold. They've got about the same amount of gold as Fort Knox. They keep that gold there, safe for you. They cover the storage costs and everything else. And on top of that, they're not allowed to do what a pawn shop would do when you want to go and sell your gold. Because if you buy physical gold, which you can do in South Africa, and you go to a pawn shop and you want to sell it, you're going to negotiate with the price with that person over the counter. There's VAT and everything else that they take into account as well. It's nothing like that here.
Okay.
You don't have to worry about it. The market maker's got to give you a fair bid and a fair offer price based upon the exchange rate and the gold price. That's it. All ETFs work exactly the same. If you buy the new fund's top 50 or the most popular one, which everybody seems to like, I don't know why, it's the most expensive one, Satrix 40, you get exposure to the top 40 shares. The market maker Satrix, which is ultimately owned by Sanlam, they actually go and buy a certain amount of those shares. And you are exposed to it. Now, what happens when those companies pay dividends? You don't own the shares. The market maker does, right? So they pay the dividends to the market makers. What does the market maker have to do? They've actually got to pass those dividends back on to you. They take their fee from that dividend. Their management fee, which is in Satrix's case 0.4%, in New Fund's top 50's case 0.1%, so you can work out the math on that, and literally pay you the dividends. So you're getting exposure to all the you're getting the dividends and everything else, but you're only going to pay for a Satrix share or for a top 50 share, you're paying around about the 50 Rand mark. And you're getting exposure to everything. Diversification. Sorted. Every single investor in this world pretty much have ETFs in their portfolio. And these are just a list of some of the ETFs that are available to you. You've got top 50s. I mean, these are all of them here. You've got things that are just tracking indexes. You can buy commodities. You want to just buy ones that pay good dividends. You can do that. You want to invest in property, but you can't afford, you don't want to take out a bond or anything else. Buy a property ETF. They track the top 10. You can get global exposure, locally, offshore, everything through an ETF without impacting your offshore allowance. If you want to invest in the top 500 companies, the S&P 500, right, which is the top 500 companies around the world, they include companies like Apple, Alphabet. Everybody knows Alphabet? They're the guys that own that Google company, okay? You can't buy Google shares, you have to buy Alphabet shares. All right, but if you want to buy any of those shares and you don't want to convert your rands to dollars, take it offshore, well, it's quite simple. Buy the core shares top 500. And it's in rands. Doesn't impact your offshore allowance at all. DBX, US, all of these things. And you can see they all have very, very funny names, core shares, the property tracks, and this thing and everything else. What we've done at Absa Stockbrokers is we've made it quite simple. If you log into the website, you type in an ETF name, you can actually get all the product information and everything else on it, so you can see what that ETF is doing. We've broken it up a bit as well into the top 50s and those type of things as well.
Okay.
But that's what you're getting. I mean, you can get exposure to everything just using ETFs. You could get the property market, commodities, offshore, locally, done. And for those of you that really and truly want to know, so we all know Warren Buffett. Yes, he's worth $40 billion. I'm not one of the people that align to his philosophy, his strategy, and we're going to talk about strategy now, because he believes in buying and holding, okay? But if you're worth $40 billion U.S. dollars, I think it's okay to sell $1 billion and use it. I don't know. He still lives in the same house he bought in 1950, and from what I understand, he drives the same car from 1950. If I'm worth $40 billion, I hate to give you bad news, I am definitely buying a Ferrari, okay? And I will call that an investment, okay? But what did Warren Buffett say? So he's 80-odd years, okay? He has two famous sayings. The first one was, he never used to do interviews, but when he did eventually, his famous saying was that when they asked him, when did you start investing? He said, I started investing at 11, and I started a bit late. Okay, and what he meant by that is that because he started investing at the age of 11, he had actually lost 11 years of investment, 11 years of growth. So if I take everybody in the room right now, yeah, and we were to just go back 5 years, you've pretty much lost about 70% worth of growth. And that's literally in something like Satrix 40.
Okay.
Your money could have grown 70%. That's literally what we mean. Okay. But anyway, what did Warren Buffett say? His second one was, because now he's obviously quite old, he said, I give advice to my trustees when I die to take 90% of every share that I own, the value of it obviously, sell everything, take 90% of it and invest it in an S&P 500, and the other 10% invested in bonds. And the reason he said that was quite simply, he says, because without fail, nobody then needs to actively worry about it, because I will outperform, as it's proven over time, outperform all portfolio managers and hedge funds and all of these type of things.
Okay.
Could you do that here in South Africa? Yeah. So you can do it quite simply. You can actually buy the core shares S&P 500, 90% of your money, you can put it in that. Then you can take another 10% and you can go into the bonds. So APSA have new funds. Their new funds bonds can give you exposure to that. New funds maps as well. In fact, MAPS is one of the best things around. It's almost like a Reg 28 compliant RA. Gives you exposure to shares, cash, all of these things.
Okay.
So now we're understanding why ETFs are so cool. And every single one of you should have an ETF if you're going to start investing. Start there, please.
Okay.
The way we work in trading and investing is there's a little pyramid. The pyramid starts at the bottom with ETFs, then you go with your large cap shares, then your medium, then your small penny cap shares, all right? Then your offshore, and then eventually derivatives.
Okay.
Cool. So now to the most important part of tonight, like I said, strategy. Why in the world would strategy have anything to do with investing? If you don't have a strategy, and the only reason why you want to invest in the stock market is to make money, I promise you the only person you're going to make wealthy is us, the brokers. So I don't mind it. Please go right ahead. Start putting money in, because when you start chasing the goal of making money, you're going to start chasing what we call the share price. And you're going to look at which shares have grown. So you're going to start buying NASPERS after tonight, because I showed you NASPERS growth. And then when you buy NASPERS, Murphy's Law without fail, the next day, Tencent comes out with horrible results and the share price drops by 5%. So what do? You sell NASPERS and then you move on to, hey, wait a minute, Barclays Africa Group is now shooting up. You go buy that. And all the time, what are you doing? You're no longer investing, you're trading. And when you start trading too much and chasing the share price, what happens? You start paying a lot in brokerage. Okay. Then what are you doing? Contributing to APSA stockbrokers and all the employees, bonuses. So all the traders, please come chat to me afterwards. I'll make your life easier. Give me your money, rather. Okay, and then just leave it at that.
Okay.
Strategy is actually so simple. And strategy will help you set up your goal, your time frame. It will help you set up your risk as well. And when I say it's so simple, it's because every single person in this room has already done strategy. So I'm going to use me as an example, and I'm going to explain to you why I say that we've all done it.
Okay.
So I'm married. I have 3 kids.
Okay.
I am going to be 40 this year. Yeah, I don't look it, right? Thanks. And if I look at that, and I'm going to go buy a car, what am I going to do? So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to sit down and I'm going to work out what can I afford. Am I going to buy the car cash? Am I going to pay it off with no balloon payment, no residual, no none of that? But which one am I going to do? Okay, lump sum or debit order, as we can call it. Right, which one am I going to do? That's the first thing. Now comes the thing of saying, okay, so let's say I can afford a 1 million rand car. What's the next steps? Start doing a bit of research on what cars fit into a 1 million rand bracket. But when I do that research, I'm going to start eliminating certain cars.
Okay.
So there's no way I'm buying, and by the way, we're buying the family car here, right? So for the family car, I cannot buy an SLK. I cannot buy a 2-seater sports roadster of any kind whatsoever. Okay? There's no way all 3 kids are going to be sitting on my lap. Right. So I have to look at a car that's going to be able to accommodate. So minimum 5 seats.
Okay.
It has to have 5 seats. Right. The next thing I'm going to look at is I have a wife, 2 girls, okay, and a son who is 4, who is a superhero and Avenger fanatic. If we're going to go on holiday ever and use that car, what am I going to need? Boot. I need a huge boot, okay? Because Iron Man and everyone can't get squashed, right? So I need a nice 5-seater with a good boot. But then I'm also going to look at my children's ages, right? I've got a 10-year-old, an 8-year-old, and a 4-year-old. What is very important to me for them is that while they're in that car, they are safe.
Okay?
So safety is very important to me, right? But at the same time, when I look at my age as well, I know they're not going to be in the car all the time. So I am going to ask the salesman on the side while they're busy playing with the car, how fast does that go? Okay, I like a bit of speed. So that's a little bit of risk that I want to take. So what's my, and then the last thing I'm going to say to myself is, how long do I plan to keep this car for? As we all know, there's no way, as much as we would like to keep a car for the rest of our lives, right, it's not actually possible because a car will eventually cost me money in a breakdown, maybe I'll have an accident, whatever the case may be. So I'm going to set a time frame of it. So most people, 5 years, some people, 10 years, depending on how often they're using the car. It can either be years or maybe mileage.
Okay?
Have I done my strategy? I have. How does that exact same strategy apply to me from investing? Simple. If I had 20,000 Rand, lump sum to invest, from a risk point of view, I'm looking at something that's pretty much low risk, but I don't mind taking a little bit on the side. Okay? So I'm going to say at least 15,000 Rand needs to go into ETFs and maybe large cap shares. The other 5,000 Rand, I can take on some higher risk and maybe split it in half, 2,500 in a penny share and 2,500 in medium cap shares. Okay. From a time point of view, I need to set that goal. I need to decide that how long or what am I investing for? Am I investing to buy another car in 5 years' time, maybe? Then that means my time frame is 5 years for my investment. Just using that as an example, it should never be 5 years and it should never be for a car, but anyway. So there's my time frame as well.
Okay.
But I've also said that, like with my car, things can happen along the way. So once I do my research and I find the right company that I want to invest in, because it suits my risk, and I believe it in 10 years' time it will actually continue producing results. I'm going to set goals, obviously, that it needs to achieve, and realistic goals. Because you're not going to buy a 4x4 SUV Land Rover and then expect that car to actually do 300 Ks. Or you're going to take the car, I don't know, onto Kyalami racetrack. It's not going to happen, right? You need to be realistic about what it can do and can't do. Same with the company that you're going to invest in. You're going to set it goals to achieve. So things like you expect a dividend yield maybe of 2%, 3% per annum. You're going to expect the company to grow by maybe 4%, 5% per annum. And that's where you've got to monitor it. Does it achieve your goals? And if it doesn't achieve the goal, do you immediately sell it? No. If you buy the Land Rover and somebody gives you just a little dent on the side, do you immediately go and sell the car? No, of course not. You go fix the dent, right? But if somebody comes, skips a robot, and literally takes out the entire front of the Land Rover where it's cut in half, do you try and rather rebuild that, or do you say write-off? That's a write-off, okay? Again, with companies that you invest in, you're going to monitor it. So for argument's sake, you end up with the die data. And a lot of people never say, oh, no, we never saw the die data problem. But it was blatantly open to them. What do we mean by that? Think about this carefully. 2000, a minor fortune. The company declares huge, massive profits and everything else because computers couldn't go from 99 to 2000. Could computers go from 2000 to 2001? Yes. The people that spent billions on servers and the likes, are they going to spend it again? No. Die Data wasn't, and Die Data themselves. They weren't planning to continuously make the billions that they were making. Fair enough, there was a bit of management issues where they didn't structure things properly in that, but that's a different thing. But you could see that was coming. Get out of your Die Data shares. Make use of stop losses. You can't keep something that is going to be totally broken in 5 years' time. So you've got to have that strategy in place. It's not achieving the goals. Understand why it's not achieving it. Not just for the simple fact that, oh, well, I said a dividend yield of 5%, it paid a dividend yield of 4%, time to sell and move on. No, why did it do that? Okay. You've got to understand the index, and you've got to have, I always say, at least 5 reasons for wanting to sell. Alternatively, take the total emotion out of it and the decision out of it from yourself and put stop losses on your investments. And stop losses are not a bad thing. It doesn't mean that if you get stopped out, you can't go back in. I mean, if we take things like Anglo, for example, Anglo American as a company, it's, I mean, 2 years ago, you were paying over 300 Rand for that share. It went right down to 50 Rand. Now, if you didn't have a stop loss in place, well, you was probably still holding the share. It hasn't come back yet to 300 Rand. But if you had a stop loss in place at even 300 Rand, for argument's sake, and it was at 350, well, you got out at 300. You could have bought now or even last year. And the price has doubled since last year. Okay? And that's what we're trying to say. So your investment isn't something that you're going to be 24/7 in front of, but you're going to have to start keeping track of things. Right? You can't just invest, leave it there and pray. Because then you may end up having an RA, a pension, and the likes, which invested in African Bank, Lehman Brothers, and all of these other places.
Okay.
Cool. Last but not least, take into account costs. And like I spoke about it earlier, costs as a percentage of your investment, and set those targets as well. Right. If you're really and truly exceptionally lazy, and you don't want to do any of this work, and don't want to look after it, then my honest advice to you is take your money and put it into exchange traded funds. They'll do all the work for you. And what they do is very nice. So I'll give you an example of Die Data. So when Die Data's price started falling, it no longer was a top 40 share. It became the 42nd share. What happens is the market makers of all these ETFs literally go and say, oh, well, what's the new top 40 share? Well, I sell all the Die Data shares and I buy this share. What happens to the price? Nothing. It's tracking an index, and the index works on what is in the index.
Okay.
So they do all the work for you. Last but not least, there are 7 rules And we have this up on our website. And if you read these rules, you'll see that it speaks to exactly what we've just spoken about, strategy. The only thing it hasn't spoken about, that we haven't spoken about, is the very first point, which it says, successful investing requires a safe environment. What do we mean by that? You can only create a safe environment with the money that you have that you can afford to lose. The risk you're taking with an investment, it must not be money that you need to pay your bond. It must not be money that you've taken out of your bond. It must not be money that you need to put food on the table. It must be money, like we say, that you do not need.
Okay.
That's the only way it's going to last for your time frame that you set. Because if you set a time frame of 10 years, but by year 5, okay, you realize that you actually need the money to pay the car off because the car had a residual and balloon payment, it's not going to work.
Okay.
Take the time, please. Go through these 7 rules. It's on our website again. It'll really help you, not just with your investments here, but in all investments. And one of the big rules that it actually talks about here is get into the market quickly and get into your investment quickly. We love postponing it. We always say, you know what, I'll do it later, I'll do it later, I'll do it later. Okay? Share prices are very, very high. Who thinks that share prices, who thinks NASPA's share price is currently high right now? Few. Okay? In 5 years' time, if NASPA's share price is 3,500 rand, what are you going to say then? Damn! Right? Okay. Guys, do your research and understand. Think about it. What does NASPA's really make its money from? A company called Tencent. Tencent is now the largest company on the stock exchange in China. Okay? So, can they do more? What are they involved in? Games, all of these type of things. Understand it. Is there potential for growth? But get into your investments now.
Okay.
If one thing I hope from tonight, please do me one favor. Walk away from here and go find out where your investments really are. And there is no financial advisor that cannot tell you where it is. An answer that your investment is Reg 28 compliant, by the way, that's just the regulation, and therefore it's split onshore, offshore, and all of these things is not the answer you need. Ask them where it is. They have to give you that answer by law, by the way.
Okay.
Cool. So now for the sales pitch. Okay, so why Absa stockbrokers? Why would I want to take my money and put it in Absa stockbrokers? Well, the first thing is, yes, we do a lot of security on our website, and especially over the last 2 years, we've spent a lot of time and effort to make sure that we can be as safe as possible. We don't allow things in there like third-party payments and all of these things, so we can reduce our risk as well. Okay? You cannot have Absa stockbrokers. Please don't go to absa.co.za. The website is absastockbrokers.co.za. It's at the back of your power bank that you have and on the pin that you have.
Okay.
But it is one of the more secure sites. I mean, I always say to somebody, if somebody eventually gets hold of your username and your password to access your stockbroking accounts, so if your wife becomes your ex-wife and she gets hold of your passwords and that, like mine in my case, if she ever becomes my ex-wife, I'm in deep trouble. She knows all my username and passwords. And she goes into my account, and what can she do? There's 3 things she can do. She can buy me more shares, and I'm hoping she buys good stuff. She can sell my shares, hopefully at the high. And she can transfer the cash to my bank account. Okay, those are the 3 things that can happen on that account. So all you need to do is make sure that you look after your username and your password. Right. That said and done, though, we actually do a lot on this website. We offer education, we offer research, and it's all free. If you go to Absa Stockbrokers right now, you can actually see there's a research tab, and you can all do it on your phone, by the way, as well, because the site is mobile friendly, so you can access things there. You can actually see the research is, you don't even have to have an account, and we give it to you for free. We've done that on purpose, not because of anything else, but we wanted to start helping South Africans start investing. We have roughly 5% of our population that actually invests in the stock market. It is the sad reality of life.
Okay.
So we've made sure we have everything there. We give you live prices when you trade. When you look at your portfolio, because you are an investor and you're not a trader, you don't need live prices when you're looking at it. because you're there to do research. When you want to trade, you need to know what you're paying. Okay? There's a lot of pump companies out there that say, we'll offer you this, this, and this, but when you go and trade, you have no idea what you're paying for that share. We give that to you. You have limit prices. You have technical analysis. So to all those people, I really do apologize to you that got scammed, where people are selling you technical analysis tools and charging you a fortune for it of 20,000 Rand plus and everything else. Technical analysis is ultimately for traders. That's really and truly where it is. But there's a lot of people that do this. They charge you a lot of money for it. Then they charge you monthly fees for data and the likes. And, well, if you think a MACD is actually the McDonald's down the road, you really wasted your money. Take the 18,000 Rand. You should have put it in an ETF.
Okay.
If you don't understand what's a MACD, and you really do think it's the McDonald's down the road, don't stress. You can learn.
Okay.
The other main reason that we are actually the choice that you should be making is because of the products we offer. We're one of the few that actually offer you what we call an ETF-only account. We want you to invest. So we've made it exceptionally cheap for you to invest. With an ETF-only account, there's no monthly fee. There's no withdrawal fees. Brokerage is at 0.2%, minimum 20 Rand. And officially, as of tonight, you people are the first to know that you can now do debit orders on that as well. So you can do debit orders on all your Satrix products, all your new funds products, DBXs, core shares, and every other ETF. You click on My Account when you logged in, and you'll see it says My Debit Orders. It's there. And you can start doing debit orders on the 1st, the 15th, any other date, Marnus? That's it. Okay. You can load it from a minimum of 250 Rand to whatever amount and for how long you want it to go. And the nice thing that we do as well is you can also set up what we call a threshold. So 250 Rand, I can't buy, and you say Satrix 40 for argument's sake, I can't exactly get to 240. So there may be some money left over, say 40 Rand left over, or 50 Rand, whatever the case may be. You can then say, if my threshold is 100 Rand, so next month we'll use the 50 Rand towards that.
Okay.
So you can trade via debit order, you can trade live, and that brokerage is most probably the cheapest. It's also the best value account around because you get live prices, you get all the information I spoke about earlier on ETFs, so you can actually understand what the ETF is doing, where is your exposure, all of these things. Performance, charting, everything on it.
Okay.
We also give you things like a weekly ETF report as well. That report, basically every week, is updated on a Monday, and it will show you the performances of all the ETFs. It will tell you exactly how it's been doing. And on top of that, it gives you something very important called TER, Total Expense Ratio. I'm not going to go into in-depth thing on it. There's actually a webinar that you can watch on our site, which we do as well. So if you go to Absa Stockbrokers, quick links, click on Smart TV, and you can view a webinar there on ETFs. And one thing we do in there is we explain why TER is so important. So if you're going to buy Satrix 40, it has a TER of about 0.45%. If you were to buy something literally like Stanlib, the TER is 0.2%. It's basically the cost. They do exactly the same thing. So why buy that when you can buy the other one, which is doing the same thing?
Okay.
So you have all that information in there. Then on top of that, tax-free savings accounts. Tax-free savings accounts, we are, again, most probably the best value in the market. 0.2% brokerage, no minimum. You put 100 Rand in, we'll charge you 20 cents. Okay, that excludes, obviously, the JSE costs. JSE always has to make money. By the way, you know why it's a good company to invest in, the JSE? Because they're still kind of the monopoly around.
Okay.
And you're paying fees to them in any case. So, anyway, tax-free savings, but the fees there are very, very low as well. JSE dropped the fees on the tax-free savings accounts as well. They do come to the party a lot. So there you've got 38, 39, if I'm not mistaken, ETFs available that was approved by National Treasury. So all the 39 ETFs that you can invest in, the ones that are excluded are things like New Gold, Platinum, and the likes, because National Treasury said the ETFs in the tax-free savings need to be as low risk as possible. So therefore, only the ones which carry diversification are allowed in it.
Okay.
33,000 Rand is your official new limit from the 1st of March per tax year. A tax year runs from the 1st of March to the end of February, 28th or 29th if it's a leap year. You have an annual limit of 33,000 Rand effective from the 1st of March this year. Okay? They've increased it from 30. Your lifetime limit of 500,000 Rand. And you can open an account for any single South African resident. You just need an ID number. That includes your kids. We don't need unabridged birth certificates because you're not traveling anywhere. But we do need some sort of proof that the child does exist.
Okay.
That's it. It's actually that simple. Yes, there's a pain. I always say to people, these are great offerings, but there is a bit of pain that goes with it. The pain is unfortunately something called FICA. And the first question I always get asked, and I promise you, we get asked this by our staff members as well. But I bank with APSA, why do you need my FICA? So the simple answer is this. APSA Stockbrokers is a totally separate and independent company, right? PTY and everything else. And because of that, there's a ruling in the JSE basically says that a bank can't be a stockbroker, but a bank can own the stockbroker, long story short. Okay? So the bank owns us, but we're a total separate company, and because of that, we therefore have to keep our own FICA as well.
Okay.
So we're going to need certified copies. All you need to do is make sure get your stuff certified, and you can actually upload it on the website. It's all online. Take a picture, scan it, upload it. All right. Last but not least, we have the Smart Account, which is obviously for all of you that want to invest in shares. So the way I work is quite simple. I have a Smart Account, I have a tax-free savings account, and I have an ETF-only account. All my ETFs are in my ETF-only account, all my shares are in my Smart Account, and tax-free savings is sitting in there. And the reason why it's tax-free savings, does everybody understand tax-free savings, just by the way? If you don't, can I ask you just to put up your hand? I'll explain it quickly. Are we all good? So we all understand it's tax-free. That 20% dividend tax that Praveen just increased does not apply in that account. There's no dividend tax even. Okay, just don't exceed the annual limit because then you pay tax. Right. If your money grows, by the way, from 33,000 Rand to 33 million Rand and you sell it, do you pay tax? No.
Okay.
Tax-free. And then last but not least, offshore investing. You can buy, if you really and truly want to, you can buy the actual S&P that Warren Buffett wants you to buy, sitting overseas, all right? You've got things like the MSCI and all of these things, but there you've got to take your rands, convert it to either dollars, pounds, or euros, transfer the money to our account offshore. And by the way, just so that you know, the money, when you transfer money to APSA stockbrokers, whether it be here locally or offshore, sits in what we call a trust account. Again, if we're not around tomorrow, the JSE takes it over, and says, hi, sorry, you owe so much of cash. Here's your cash back if you want it. So your money's very safe in that sense. We can't touch it. I can't use that money for anything. Okay? So you transfer your money offshore. Once it's offshore with your World Trader account, you can then go and buy shares in Google, sorry, in Alphabet, Apple. You can buy in Warsaw even. Okay? The Warsaw Exchange is there because it was offered to us for free, so we grabbed it. I don't know what shares are on the Warsaw Exchange, so my apologies. But you can buy virtually anywhere in the world.
Okay.
Everything local, everything offshore. And the other main thing is, for once, APSA Stockbrokers is really and truly doing phenomenally well in the sense of what we're doing for our customers. We're improving every single time. Okay. If we take 2 years ago, APSA Stockbrokers was actually rated the 18th best stockbroker. That's 1-8, not 8-0. But pretty much 18th was almost lost. In 2 years, we're sitting at 6th. And one of the reasons we are sitting at 6th and not higher up is because we do not have derivatives yet. So CFDs and the likes. But we're not too phased on that because we want to start helping people first to invest before they start trading.
Okay.
You're going to be getting an app very soon as well. So you're going to be able to access all of this on your app. All right, share alerts, stop losses, and all of it will be in there. We're upgrading our technical analysis so we can make sure that we try to offer you guys better graphs and everything else. And like I said, as of tonight, you all know that there's officially now debit orders as well that you can do.
Okay,
I'm done.